thank you for inviting me to this fantastic conference that the city of Wiesbaden has put on to look at the Swedish approach to prostitution and human trafficking, and of course the German approach to the similar topic. I specifically want to thank Manu Schön for having organized this. It is always a pleasure for me to come to Germany. There was a time in my life when we were not invited, and now I can see a real change in how prostitution is discussed in the context of male violence, which is a very hopeful sign for the future. Today I'm going to do a few things. I'm going to talk a little bit about critical source analysis, because I usually teach students, and in this time, interesting times that we live in, we really need to learn how to analyze material that we are giving and be critical. But we'll come back to that. I'm also going to look at international law connected to prostitution and trafficking, and specifically the obligations that member states have to implement these different conventions. Then we're going to take a little look at the background of how the Swedish approach came into place. And then I'm going to go down into the effects, the results and the effects of our approach. And I'm going to finalize it with telling you about what not to do. Critical source analysis is something that's really important, and we often forget when we deal with controversial issues that we have to look at the reliability of the information that we get. In controversial issues, there's often a mix of facts and opinions. And there's also, when we talk about prostitution, a lot of myths that are put forward that are not based in data and relevance. So when I teach students, I think that they need to look at what is in the material, who is writing the material or who is presenting the material, and where was it published. And so that goes for all information about prostitution, and you need to do the same thing about what we are doing. We in Sweden, we are trying to base our activities and actions in facts. And if we don't have the facts, when we put it in, we do a review. And I suggest that you look at the material, and I have put sources in here if you want to look at it. Something that's really important when you work on social problems, if you like, or social phenomenon, is to look to the terminology that we use, the language. And we have to make sure that the words we use have to have a direct link to the principles and values that we're trying to express in our actions. So for example, it's a bit complex, but for example, if I want to do measures against rape, I have two different options to talk about it. I can talk to say, stop rape, which is much more of a umbrella term, but if I'm really serious about it, I would probably say stop rapists, because then we are identifying the agent who is doing this, and we're also saying there is somebody who is doing something to somebody else. In human rights law, which is what I'm trained into, it's very important to look at power differences and see how that affects our measures. We can make sure that we don't support the oppressor, and we have to always stand with the victim or the ones who are subjected. And let's just look at how the different language issues, the terminologies that surrounds the topic of prostitution and trafficking, and the international debate that's been going on for years now. I've made a little schedule here. There's many points in it, but I think I'm intending to look at four of them, which are the most important differences in how we express. So in Sweden, we see prostitution as violence against women. In Germany and other countries, prostitution can be seen as a choice or relevant work experience, if you like. Arguments that we hear from those who think that the German system is good or the prostitutionist work often argue that prostitution is a profession and that it's the oldest profession in the world. And importantly, there's nothing we can do about it. It will always exist. Men will always try and purchase sexual services. In And us who think that prostitution is sex discrimination, violence against women, we don't accept the argument that we cannot eliminate this. Instead, we say that prostitution is the oldest oppression in the world, and it is discrimination based on sex, intersected with other oppressions, like, for example, ethnicity, nationality, and different. And importantly, instead of accepting it, as, for example, in the Netherlands, where they say, we have to be pragmatic, we know this is always going to exist, and we're going to control it. We say we should challenge that attitude, and we should eliminate prostitution. We have to have the long-term objective to elimination. We are quite aware that we're not going to end prostitution tomorrow. But by having a long-term objective to elimination, our actions, our language, will then follow that. Everything we do is intended to reach the point where no one purchases sexual services anymore, and no one, women, men, children, others, are not exploited in prostitution. In those who defend prostitution as work often argue that women can and they do choose to be active in prostitution, and their reasons are valid. We don't dispute the validity of why women are in prostitution, but we do dispute the idea of choice. Real choice can only happen if an individual have the opportunity to choose between two equal alternatives. I'm sure, just like you, like me, you have been in jobs you don't like. But I have to stay in that job because I need the income. It's not my choice to stay there. I would like to leave because of all reasons. It's underpaid. Maybe the office environment is terrible. There's sexual harassment. But not until I find another source of income will I be able to leave. And if you look at prostitution, you have to understand it's not a choice. It's a decision that you make in a different context. So, for example, if you have in a situation of poverty, you may make a decision to end up in prostitution. That doesn't mean that it's an active choice because you don't have an alternative. And I think it's oppressive against women who are in prostitution to leave them alone and say, you chose this, and because you chose it, you get out of it on your own. I remember a situation in the Netherlands when I was doing research where I had a conversation with an earlier national rapporteur, and I asked her, you say that prostitution is work, but it's not like regular work, it's a different kind of work. And so what do you do if women wants to leave prostitution to make sure that, you know, they don't want to be stuck here? And they said, it's not part of our program to assist. Because you got yourself in, you get yourself out. Now, that attitude has changed in the Netherlands now, but it's a very individualistic approach where you point to the individual as the one who makes these decisions. And we know that it's more complicated than that. Another argument is, of course, that I already touched upon, is that prostitution is work. It's legitimate. And they should get all the benefits that other workers do, like access to healthcare, social services, and so forth, whatever is part of the social services universe in a country. We believe that, of course, it's not work. And the International Labour Organization, which is not necessarily a friend of us who work for to eliminate prostitution and see it as male violence against women, they have added prostitution as a legitimate work in their list. But they also talk about what is decent work. A decent work, they define work should be a source of personal dignity and stability of the family and the stability and peace in the community, etc. We have to remember that the international human rights framework, when it comes to prostitution and trafficking in human beings, has been very clear on the point of dignity. It says, even in the Human Rights Declaration, that dignity, that prostitution is counter to the human dignity. And I think it's important to remember that we can't rewrite something that, for political reasons, we want to be seen as work or a choice, and not look at what that work entails. To talk about what women experience in prostitution, and I will take you through a schedule soon where you can see how we analyze it. It's a human right to do sex work. Well, anyone, of course, can be in prostitution. In Sweden, it's not criminal for women to be in prostitution or anybody else. In fact, women have a right to service victim support services and to get out of prostitution should they want it. And as I said before, the international human rights principles say that prostitution and trafficking is incompatible with the dignity and worth of the human person. So there's it collides. These arguments collide. And I think that it's really important for all of you to think about these concepts and see and analyze them so you understand where these arguments come from and what it entails. And I'm just going to skip those. As you've noticed, I talk a lot about women and girls in connection with prostitution and trafficking, and there's a real good reason for that. Of course, the policies in Sweden, the Swedish approach, the right to not be in prostitution, everyone is under that umbrella. No one, whether you are a woman or a man or a child or you come from whatever background, you have a right not to be in prostitution, and you have a right to live a life without violence. But it's still important to recognize that we live in a patriarchal society, we live in a male-dominated society all across the world. There are power differences between men and women, and that plays out in prostitution. Prostitution, we can see as the keystone. Keystone is the stone in churches that holds up the whole thing. It's a keystone of prostitution, a male-dominated society, because women in prostitution experience all of the different forms of male violence on a daily basis. And we need to think about how we deal with us. So just to look a little bit about the data, Eurostat, which is the European Union's statistical bureau, does collect data from the member states regularly on human trafficking. And they have concluded for many years that the majority of all victims of human trafficking within the EU are women and girls, and the majority are exploited in prostitution or sexual exploitation. And you can see the data here that in 2021, two of three victims of human trafficking were women or female. And we can see this also, only one out of five suspected traffickers were female. That tells us that, again, that there is a power difference here, that men abuse and control and exploit and transport, etc., whereas women are the victims, not the controllers. And two-thirds of registered victims are women and girls. Also, the United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime, which is the one who was responsible for a treaty that we're going to talk about, the Palermo Protocol, also do global reports on the numbers of victims in human trafficking. And there we could see in 2020 that 42% of all victims of human trafficking were women and 18% were girls. So again, a large dominance of females as victims. Something that they also concluded that I think is important to remember when you try to defend prostitution as something positive is that female victims are subjected to physical or extreme violence at the hands of traffickers. Extreme violence is not a wording that is used in international context except for when it's really, really serious. And the extreme violence is three times more likely if you're a woman than if you're a male. And we also, I think it's important to also recognize now, which is one of the principles in Sweden, and that is that we see prostitution and human trafficking linked. Internationally, some groups have tried to de-link this, to say that human trafficking, yeah, we're all against human trafficking, but prostitution, that's a national issue, and that's none of your business. We know, of course, and we've known this all along, that traffickers move women around because men who purchase sexual services want to have new faces and new bodies regularly. So, and that can be, it's not necessarily over borders, but it's also very much between brothels, legal or illegal, depending on what country you're in. In the same town, it can be between cities, it can be between regions in a country, and cross-border. So there's no reason to believe that there is no link between these two phenomena. In fact, before some of these international conventions came into place, it was not even debated that there would be two separate issues. There was a movement in the 90s where there was advocates who wanted to make sure that prostitution could continue to be work, but that we all worked against human trafficking. Now, as you notice, my title to my talk was that prostitution is a barrier to sex equality. And I think it's important to talk about what definitions we use when we use when we talk about equality. Many of the international instruments and also local policies in countries are based on formal equality, meaning that men and women should have equal opportunities to do certain things, to have the same salary, to be able to do all of the different kinds of jobs equally, and not be not that women would lose out when it comes to promotion in work, etc. And we are also, lately, we've made sure a lot in the European unions that when there's been an election and there's a new government to be formed, many of the parties have made sure that we have a formal equality focus, meaning we had 50% women as ministers and 50% men as ministers. That's formal equality. There's a balance like that. But we have to remember, when we look at that government, we also have to think about which roles did women get? So what kind of posts as ministers are women given? It's often social affairs, education, health, important topics, but not seen as heavy within a government. And often those ministers have less to say when there's government decisions. And then men usually get finances, which is, of course, a key role in a government. They get to be the prime minister, and they get to get the defense. And so when we start looking at that and we say, well, this is not fair, this is formal equality, but what about? Then we move over to what I call substantive sexual equality, which means that we identify and take into consideration power differences between men and women. And we make everything we can to try and improve the discriminatory effects and impact so that women and men in reality substantively have the same access to similar. And if we recognize that there is a power difference, we also do special measures to lift women and girls up to the same status as men have, which means that in some contexts people will see that as discrimination or reverse discrimination. Why are women getting all of those benefits when men don't? We hear that a lot. And that is because as a class, women have less power. And so we need to do special measures to lift them. And the work, the Swedish approach to prevent and combat prostitution and trafficking is based on substantive sexual equality, sex equality, meaning that we have a lot of measures that are targeting women and girls. I also think it's really important that we recognize the international law, the treaties that we have over time agreed to in all of our countries to better the position of women, and also to target prostitution and trafficking as part of that. The Women's Convention, or the CEDAW Convention, came out of grassroots work by feminists in the 1970s. Very first convention that came out from the grassroots rather than from the politicians. Another convention that was also from grassroots, that was part of the decolonization of Africa and other places, was the convention against racial discrimination, for example. So, and that's important to know that there's a difference, because when it comes from the grassroots, there's knowledge behind. There's practical, true, real knowledge of the problem that we're trying to solve. The reason why women turned to international law was that they did not get heard on a national basis. It was really important at that time to recognize male violence as a problem against women in many countries, but at that time, often it was seen as a private matter. So what happened in the home was not the business of the state. Now, luckily, that has changed. And if you do look at the convention, the CEDAW convention, you will see that no one talks about male violence in the convention text. And as I said, in 1979, that was seen as controversial, as prostitution and trafficking is today. But that was changed a couple of years later when the convention came into force, and the CEDAW committee, which is the committee that looks into how member states are actually implementing, they put out what is called a general recommendation saying that male violence is part and should be reported on. So that changed very quickly. Also pressures from the women's movement, the feminist movement. But what's interesting with the CEDAW convention, which Germany ratified in 1985, so it's binding to Germany, Sweden has also obviously ratified it, and also binding to Sweden, is that, first of all, states have to condemn discrimination. They have to refrain from discriminating, and they have to do everything they can to stop discrimination. But for our purpose today, the most important thing is Article 6. And Article 6 is one of those rare creatures in international law because it is obligatory. Usually in international law, it's kind of vague. If you have the you know, the resources and you have the interest, you can do this. But this paragraph says shall, which means there is no turning away from it. You shall, if you have ratified this convention, do everything you can, including legislation, to suppress trafficking in women and the exploitation of prostitution and women. Now, how does that apply to Germany, and how does that apply to Sweden? I think that's a topic of discussion that I think is interesting. This was 1985, it's many years ago. How does the system of legalization in Germany fit with this? Are Germany in breach? Yes, I would say that Germany in breach of this convention on this paragraph. When we started to kind of do the Swedish approach, which is not just legislation that criminalizes the men who purchase sexual services, but a number of other measures that I will talk about later, we decided to use the CEDAW Convention, Article 6, and the United Nations Declaration on the Elimination of Violence Against Women, which is not a binding instrument, but is an expression of the United Nations member states, what they think should be done against violence against women. And the preamble is very interesting because it has absorbed the feminist analysis of what is male violence against women, because they recognize that violence against women is a manifestation of historically unequal power relations. So they actually recognize that there is substantive power differences between men and women, and that has led to domination over and discrimination of women. And from a Swedish point of view, we see, as I said, prostitution is a central issue in discriminating women and girls. Because if you are allowing men the privilege of paying for sexual services and exploiting women, those women who are in prostitution don't get all of the measures that women are allowed to get the support. So, for example, If I was sexually harassed today by somebody, I could turn to the police and say, you know, this person, this man sexually harassed me, do something. If I'm at the same day a woman in prostitution here in Germany, nobody would take me seriously. Because that's part of the job, to be sexually harassed or sexually exploited. And so we're creating a power differences, not just between men and women, but certain women are given protection, whether other women are not. So this is also a problem that needs to be talked about. And by the way, prostitution and trafficking are included as forms of violence in this declaration. And then we have the Istanbul Convention, which is a much newer convention that came out of all of the work that feminists have done for so many years to try and prevent and combat male violence against women, everything from domestic violence to rape to... And there was a lot of debate during the negotiations for this, whether prostitution should be included or not. And there were countries, including Germany, who were opposed, which is... And there was lots of others that were supporting our point of view that, of course, it should be included. The compromise is that in the convention there is a sub-article which talks about that all measures should to prevent and combat violence against women should also be non-discriminatory. And so, and there's a listing in the explanatory notes to the convention that includes women in prostitution. So this is also a convention that Germany has ratified. There is an absolute obligation by states to ensure that all women in a country are protected from male violence. And women in prostitution are one of them. Is this compatible with the system here? A question you're going to have to ask yourself. As I understand, the Istanbul Convention is very much discussed here in Germany at this time, and I think it's really important that we look at the aspect of how do we ensure that women in prostitution have the same protection and the same rights as other women. Now, why do we keep saying it's male violence? What is it with prostitution that's male violence? Well, I've created these four questions. I may answer some of them, but whatever you do, feel free to take a photo of it and think about the questions. And the first question is, if we're going to find who is in prostitution and why it's violence against women, who are the women and girls who are sold and bought and exploited through prostitution? Well, we know that a large number of women and girls who are exploited in prostitution have a background of having been exploited prior to ending up in the prostitution industry. They have been subjected to child sexual abuse, for example. Family members, usually male, have sold them to friends, and then they've been pushed into the prostitution industry. We know that women who have economic difficulties sometimes end up in prostitution because they say they've been told that being in a strip club, it's okay. You know, you're on stage. And we know that strip clubs are the major recruitment centers in many countries for getting women into prostitution. We also know that racialized women are a large majority of women in prostitution because of the, as I said before, the multiple dimension of oppression. Where, for example, in the project that I was doing with the Swedish police authority and ended just a few weeks ago, we could conclude that the women that were exploited in the part of the prostitution industry we were looking at came from an extreme oppressed subculture where cultural traditions made them endure prostitution, not because they wanted to. And I know when we started this, the police came to me and said, but what do you mean? The women are smiling when we go in there. And I said, to smile is not consent. Smile is a survival technique that we use, a lot of us, in many situations, to not be violated. You know, walking down the street and somebody whistles at you and say, hey, you, I'll smile. Well, I won't, but many of us have to smile to just get out of there so that they won't do more. So smiling is not an indication of oppression. Sorry, of of liking what you're doing. The second question is, now I don't have the time because that thing is not working, so you're going to have to tell me when, where I am. The second question is, and this is the one that most of those who think prostitution is work don't want to touch, and that is, what do women experience in prostitution? Well, it is a sexual act. It's sexual harassment. It's somebody who touches you, somebody who have you talk about the buyer as if he's a good man, if he's lovely. You've been penetrated. You do. You are often subjected to all kinds of horrible sexual acts that men find in prostitution and want to play out on women in prostitution. So, is that what we experienced in regular work? Well, part of it, the sexual harassment, maybe, but the rest of it. Is that work? If that happened to me when I worked at the Swedish Police Authority, I could definitely have that person charged. But because we have created this industry where they're untouchable, anything can be done to women. So that question is, and so what are the consequences of having been in prostitution on an individual level? I think others are going to talk about that today, so I won't go into that, but just to say that there are long and short-term serious consequences when you have been exploited. And then we have to look at the political aspect of prostitution. What happens to society? What happens to a society where it's okay for men to pay 15 euros to go into a brothel and use a woman who's often from another country, but not always, what does that do to a society? What does that do to the role of women in that society? When I was articling as a lawyer, articling means the trainee period before you become, in my case, a barrister and solicitor, I was often taking my lunch. It was in Vancouver, in British Columbia, and I was taking my lunch at the central square downtown where all of the skyscrapers are and which are filled with law firms. Corporate law firms, and then the courthouse. And I was sitting there one day, and suddenly I see a lawyer that I met in court the day before with one of the judges who I'd met in court a couple of days before passing by and going into that skyscraper where I know there's a brothel. And unfortunately, the brothel was called the Swedish Touch, which is really quite horrific when you think about it. And then I found out, because the clerks, the trainees of the judges, contacted us, who were older and were absolutely upset because they came back into the chambers of the judges and bragged about it, that they had spent their lunch hour with using women in prostitution. What did that have the effect of the young women who were clerking for those judges? What did it do to me when I had to meet this lawyer again? And I can't in court, I can't say anything. Hey, I know you were at the brothel yesterday. That is impacting how you are dealing with what we're doing. And of course, there are many others. So you have to think about what other aspect. Oh, I can give you another example. A young woman that I know in Munich was raped. And she went to court. She was very brave. And the rapist was found. It was actually a street in the street, so it was not somebody she knew. And the judge said in the conclusion of the case that it was understandable that the man had done this because he had not been able to access prostitution in a brothel for a couple of days, so he used it. So there is in all kinds of levels of changes to a society when you think that it is okay, when men think that this is totally all right. So I would like you to think about all of those questions when you have time, and if you want to discuss it with me in the break, feel free. And I just wanted for international law just to talk about the international treaty that is underlying all of the legislation on human trafficking around the world now, and that is what's called the Palermo Protocol. It's a legislation or a convention based under the Convention Against Transnational Organized Crime, and that tells us something. It is a legal law enforcement protocol. But there are aspects of it. I was part of the negotiations for this, and I proudly can say that I was with other of colleagues, we were responsible for some of the wording here. Article 3 is interesting because it says that the consent of somebody who is a victim of trafficking is irrelevant. So it doesn't matter if somebody, a woman, comes from Romania and she's in a brothel here in Wiesbaden. It is not her we should worry about. It is the intention of the trafficker to exploit her. That is underlined very clearly. And so consent, put it aside. Just look at what did the pimp, the facilitator, the you know, the trafficker, the organized crime group, whoever was involved doing this, what was their intention? And she doesn't even have to be exploited. It is the intent to exploit. That is the interesting part. So you can interfere as a law enforcement person. You can interfere before a woman is exploited. If all the other indications, I'm turning to my colleagues here from Sweden, doesn't have to be a completed exploitation, it's the intention. And then, of course, Article 9.5 that we are very proud of, and that is the one that says that every, and it's obligatory, one of those that are so few of, as I said before, it's obligatory to put into place laws or other measures to discourage the demand. Clearly spoken, Germany ratified it 2006, but I can say that the German government was not very keen on this aspect when during the negotiations, and so weren't all of the other countries that have legalized or done decriminalized prostitution industry. But that one is very useful. We've used it in many countries to initiate debates on how to change legislation to make those who are the main and immediate exploiters liable under law. So just a very quick, I'm not going to go through all of this, but consent is always the interesting part. And it's interesting how consent floats into prostitution. How can you consent to prostitution? Impossible. But just to make sure, consent has to be freely given. You have not, you cannot be under pressure for somebody to be, you know, to say that you have consented to someone. And I know you're probably going to talk about that, but I know that many of the women I've met in who have been in prostitution said, well, I consented to it. A young woman I met not so long ago, who had economic difficulties, went into a strip club and was so concerned because she didn't think anyone would help her because she walked in there herself. And she thought she had consented. And I said, not a chance. Well, how would you know what was going to happen? Huh? How would you know? She ended up in prostitution, obviously, and sliding into prostitution were more and more demands from the owner of a strip club, men in the strip club, blah, blah. And another aspect of it, you cannot consent to something that is harmful to you. And this is nothing odd. This is in most of the laws in most countries. You can't consent to be murdered. You can't consent to all kinds of other things, to an assault, because that's voids. That's not a defense under criminal law. So why is it suddenly okay when it comes to prostitution? And excuse me, this is some other I want to. Yeah, consent is only valid if the person who is assumed to have consented has full control. She can leave when she wants to. She can tell the pimp to go do something with him. You know, very important. Otherwise, it's not consent. It's something you're forced into by all kinds of means. So all of this is behind what we have been doing for the last 24 years in Sweden. So now I'm going to talk, what time are we now? I said I want to get to the last part. And how many minutes have I left? Forty-five. I thought it was, yeah. Good. Then I can continue to ramble. So the Swedish approach, or what's called internationally the Nordic model, is often presented as a very narrow criminalizing the buyers. And that is, of course, as we said before, it's the root cause. It is the core aspect. But when we did this, when I was responsible, it was, of course, not just criminalizing the buyers. It's a big package of measures. And I'm going to go through the principles after this. But if you look here, these are the important aspects. So it's based on feminist and human rights principles that we will talk about soon. And the elimination of prostitution and human trafficking is a political priority. And that means, in concrete terms, that the governments, successive governments, have since 1999 made the elimination of prostitution and trafficking in human beings a political priority, no matter their political background, because the decision to pass the legislation on violence, male violence against women, and the law that criminalizes the purchase of sexual services was actually a cross-party agreement, except for one. And unfortunately, the one who did not vote for it is now in power in Sweden, which is going to be interesting for the future, I'm afraid. We think it's really important to recognize the harm of prostitution, but also to do something about the harm. You know, be aware. So, for example, when we first started, we had lots of training with police officers who were working on these issues, not just how to do the investigative work, because they know that, that's their specialty, but how to think about prostitution and why, as I said before, when you go into a brothel and you're to arrest a pimp or find out more or get the buyers, if the women look not uncomfortable, it doesn't mean that they comply. There are reasons, all kinds of survival mechanisms for why you're not screaming and saying, take me out of here. Because you are, as I said before, if you're a victim of male violence in a home, you get groomed into believing that this is your universe. Criminalization, robust investigations, and prosecution of the chain of perpetrators. And that includes organized crime groups. Because we know that organized crime is behind a lot of these. In Sweden, it's smaller groups because of the result of this approach. But in Germany, we know it's large organized crime groups, often from third countries, who are involved with localized, for example, criminal motorcycle gangs and others who are facilitating it locally. And but to be able to do that, you have to have resources. You have to have a leadership of the police that actually see it as a priority. You have to give indications from the government to the police to investigate, which is done in Sweden every year. You have to have continuing education and training of police officers, prosecutors, police teams. Our problem is the judges. We have real problems with judges not taking our policies seriously. And we've had, just the latest few days, several men who purchased sexual services who've been freed, which is absolutely unacceptable. But that judges are judges. Adapted counseling and exit programs are a core feature of the approach, but not very successful always, as is with every action measure that is on male violence. There's always not enough money to do this. The redistribution of funds is not always made as it should be, although we've had quite a lot of money being dedicated to it. And we have municipal victim support agencies, some of whom will be here and talk about what they do later today. And then, of course, we also have men who are caught purchasing or attempting to purchase sexual services have the possibility of going to counseling, not for them to just talk about this, but to actually end their abusive behavior. So the intention is to stop it, although all kinds of things come up, obviously. And a lot of the men who are being criminalized under the legislation are forced by their partners, usually, to go to the counseling service when the women find out, either I will divorce you or you do something about this. And I've interviewed lots of men who buy sexual services, so we'll talk about that later. And an important aspect is a review, not of the laws, policies, and such, as such, but the enforcement of it. So how do we do this? Can we do it better? So, for example, we'll look at that later, but for example, we have changed the law that criminalizes the purchase of sexual services, I think, 4 times now to strengthen it. So we've gone from one, and now we're going to a more stronger wording in the text. I just wanted to talk a little bit about the background, because it is important, and I think it's important in all countries, and we've seen it in other countries that have taken on and made changes to their laws and policies, that a strong feminist movement who's pushing from grassroots level have been core to get this policy in place. Because women work with women in prostitution. Women in prostitution are part of the feminist movement. There's a deep understanding of the results and consequences of having prostitution in a country. So you can just see that. But that was, we started in the 70s, where the women's movement was very strong all over the world. And in our base groups, where we were discussing all kinds of oppressive techniques against women, there were women, of course, who represented women or who were themselves had experience having been in prostitution and said, we need to talk about prostitution also, not just rape and domestic violence, but also the situation of what we are subjected to in prostitution. And that was kind of integrated into the feminist movement. And we're going to ignore that because we don't have time. I want to talk about the principles, and by now you know them, I'm sure, so we can do it together. 1, 2, 3. Prostitution is a barrier to sex equality. Its violence is a barrier to gender equality. It's harmful to society as well as women in prostitution or other in prostitution. Everyone, of course, who's prostituted should have the same protection as women. It's incompatible with international human rights principles. We talked about that. It is a sex-specific crime, meaning the majority of those who are victims of prostitution and trafficking for sexual exploitations are women and girls. But boys and young men are also targeted. Importantly, which was mentioned here in the introduction, that women or whoever is in prostitution in Sweden are not criminalized. Not in any shape or form, not through criminal law, not from administrative law. We just don't want that to happen. So instead, women are given the opportunity to take part in counseling and exit programs, and should be more. But we have, when some of the police officers, when they go and do raids on illegal brothels, they bring social workers with them. And you can talk more about that if you want to later. And, of course, consent is irrelevant. We see, and another interesting thing with those who think sex prostitution is sex work is that they de-link prostitution and human trafficking as if it was not connected. And that's bullshit, of course, because women in prostitution are trafficked. They can be trafficked within the same city, from one brothel to the other. They can be trafficked between two cities, or they can be cross-border trafficked. There's always a pimp, a trafficker, who move women around, because as pimps say themselves, men get bored. They need to have a constant flow of new women to be able to satisfy whatever they're seeking in prostitution. So the pimps, to make most money, move women around. We can see, for example, that women are moved from Sweden to Norway, from Norway to Denmark, from Denmark to Germany, from Germany to Denmark, to Sweden, to Finland. Same women, they tell us. And it's not about the women making money. It is about men who are controlling them, make money to make sure that the women are interesting for women. Eliminating the demand is a cornerstone. And importantly, which we were very actively when I was in the government, that in any EU meeting, there were discussion of human traffickers, the politician had to say, we are opposed to the legalization of prostitution activities. Completely and totally opposed. Any legal or policy measure that says the prostitution is acceptable is not acceptable under the Swedish approach. And finally, the legalization of prostitution normalizes an extreme form of sexual violence. Yeah. Questions? No, you're not supposed to do that. sorry. But even though it is a package deal, because I don't have a whole day, we will just talk about the offense that prohibits the purchase of a sexual service. It's very simple. Anyone who has a casual sexual relationship for payment is guilty of the purchase of a sexual service. Nothing complicated. If you do that and you meet a police officer, you are breaking the law and you are to be prosecuted or meet a prosecutor. This legislation changed when we first passed it in 1999. It was given day fines, so men had to pay a fine based on their annual income per day, which was very low, because we knew we couldn't pass a very stringent law at that time. It would not have been accepted. We always have to do compromises. This was not a happy compromise, but we had to do that. And over the years, the sentencing has been increased. And since last year, 1st of August, the day fines are now no longer in the law, and now it is 1 year prison sentence. The problem, again, since then, has been the courts. Because the courts have given suspended sentences to all of the men who have so far purchased and been convicted in court. We haven't had one prison sentence. And so there's a lot to be done, again, like we've done for the past 24 years, education, understanding that this is harmful, and all of that. But at least it's on the books now, and there is a potential when there's a shift in the core of justice, judges, that maybe we're getting younger judges that understands more about prostitution, and we will have a one-year sentence. Important thing with this legislation is that attempts are criminalized. And this is a debate that we've had with the police since, because of course it's easier to prove that somebody is breaking this legislation if he actually has had interaction with a woman in prostitution. But the whole intention when we did this was to stop the sexual exploitation of women before they were exploited. And so to learn about what an attempt is really important. And we have court decisions for what is an attempt. And it's enough to sending an email to a website where women are advertised. Early court decision. I can give it to you. And so it's not much needed. But there's always, you know, we have to deal with the reality, so we educate, and hopefully one day all attempts will be punished. So you can just see the first conviction under the amended offense was a 40-year-old man, who purchased a woman from Ukraine, which is interesting, in 2022, so it was after the war had started. So immediately, of course, organized crime groups who were already established in Europe sent women to all of Ukrainian women who were in dire straits ended up in Sweden. And he got, as you can say, a suspended sentence plus 40-day fines. We also, I'm not going to talk about this, but of course the exploitation of a child through the purchase of a sexual act is also criminalized. So anyone who's 18 and under falls under this. Not much to say about that, but it's being implemented. There's a lot of sugar dating investigations going on. Personally, I think that sugar dating is just a new version of the exploitation, the sexual exploitation of children, just a new tool that pimps and the men who buy them use. It's now technologically facilitated, but it's the same old way of sexually abusing children. So just let's just look, because it's interesting how, again, facts that are not facts floats around in the world about the successes and failures of our approach. Look at the last highlighted yellow number, 13,745 men have been reported under this legislation since the 1st of January 1999. That's almost 15,000 men. And even though not all of them have been charged and prosecuted, they certainly have had their lives disrupted by this. And it's also interesting, if you look at the numbers, if you can see from 2009 to 2010, or rather from 2008 to 2010, it's been an incredible increase in the prosecution or the reporting of men who purchase sexual services. So we can see here how the police has interpreted the legislation, so how much of a priority it's been. So in 2010, it was a very strong priority to do something about this. And then it's gone up and down, and you can see it's very high numbers now, because it is, again, a priority. Since 2018, after the big reorganization of the Swedish police in 2015, and so 13,745 men. Not one woman have been reported under this legislation. And the police officers are not afraid of charging if they found a woman, right? No. So there have been no women in these prostitution. That tells us something also, doesn't it? And this is just procuring. We don't need to talk about these laws, because, and this is the trafficking in human being cases. We don't need to. But this we can talk a little bit about. I talked about that a review of laws, policies, and actions is a necessary aspect, but not whether or not the law should be there, but how it's implemented and what we can do to strengthen it. And in 2010, or from 2008 to 2010, there was a review, 10 years after the legislation came in place, looking at what was the consequences of this package of measures. And we could see that, for example, there's a clear connection between prostitution activities and trafficking in human beings. Not that we didn't know that, but now it's on paper. The number of individuals exploited in street prostitution went down considerably, but that is, of course, not just due to the approach, but also the move from, and if you remember, around 2000, that's when suddenly social media, and we got email, and we got all kinds of chat rooms and possibilities to sell women digitally instead of in street prostitution. But there was a comparative research done between our neighboring countries, where they at the time did not have the legislation, and there was not, we could see that keeping it level, the numbers involved in prostitution, was not, was the result of the implementation of the offenses. And if there was an increase, it was because the use of technologies. If you look at the time, if you look at Norway and Denmark, Denmark had triple the number of women in prostitution, and they have not implemented this. There are brothels everywhere in Denmark, if you go there. Norway has the same law, but it's been implemented so-so over the years, but they still have it. There is no indication that the violence against women in prostitution increased, for example. There are lots of other conclusions, but time is short. So let's look at the men who we know purchase sexual services. This and the first poster and the third poster was part of the first ever anti-demand campaign that was mentioned before, the Nordic Baltic campaign, where all of the five Nordic countries and the three Baltic countries did all kinds of measures over 2 years to discouraged the demand. Even the countries that were against doing that did it. And I was the coordinator. I'll never do that again. Coordinating eight governments. It was exciting. But anyway, we did posters that were all over Sweden, in all of the bus shelters, in the subway, where it, this one was even married men purchase sexual services. Yes, a wedding ring. Let's move that. Oh, why is this? Oh, I'm going backwards. Ah, so this can be said. So, yeah, I have had the privilege, or whatever you want to call it, of interviewing men who purchase sexual services in Belgium and in Sweden, and was involved also in being the expert of a big study in Lebanon. So very different cultural context. But the thing that's interesting is that the conclusions are exactly the same in all of these very different cultural contexts. We know that men who purchase, we know that all men purchase sexual services, but not all men, if you know what I mean. So men coming from all of class backgrounds, cultural backgrounds, nationalities, ethnicities, they look about the same. It's the same ages, it's the same. Most of them are in a relationship with a woman. Many of them have children. The men who have other sexual partners are the most common buyers. And why is that, you would think? Well, that is because prostitution is all about male sexuality, which we talk a lot about, or used to talk a lot about, Sweden, how male sexuality is directed towards having as many potential chances to be sexual with someone. So when we did this campaign, I asked around for my colleagues at the Swedish government, the ministers and whoever, what they thought if they ended up not being in a sexual relationship. And a few of them said, well, I would probably contemplate going to a woman in prostitution, which is interesting. We know that the internet is key now, these days, to contacting a woman in prostitution by looking at websites where women are pornographied with pictures of them being in different difficult positions with no clothes, and men can go in there and they can decide who they want to buy. And it was very obvious when I did the study in Belgium, where we could see that Belgian men, white Belgian men, always looked for women who were of African descent. There's a long history of colonialism in Belgium, in Africa, and that played out so clearly in what they wanted to buy. It's very interesting, I think. We know that men like to go to massage parlors in Sweden. They also like to have women sent to their homes because they think that they are less likely to be found by the police if they have the woman at home, which of course makes her life incredibly insecure, very difficult. You're in an abuser's home and you can't leave and not get until you got the money. We also know that when men are arrested under this legislation, it does have an impact on a lot of men. They will not buy in Sweden. We also know, however, that most men in all of these countries like to buy women when they're not in their home territory. And that has nothing to do about... It has to do with not wanting the wife to know, or the work colleagues, or the school, or whatever. They prefer to do it away from home so they cannot be revealed. But a lot of them also do it at home because they need to go from the home and they don't want to explain that they've been in a prostitution business to purchase. So they go after work, or they go when they go to a football game or whatever. We went, when we started this, we went from 13.6% men in Sweden purchase sexual services down to 7.8%, so half. In 2019, the population survey showed, and population surveys are huge surveys on all kinds of aspects. And in Sweden, we do population surveys on sexual attitudes every 10 years, about. It's been done since the 1960s, and incredibly interesting to read. And it's lots of questions that are sent out to about 50,000 individuals who they answered. And in that population study, we saw that it's 9.4% now that have purchased sexual services. 80% did it outside of the country when they were traveling. And as our interviews with Swedish buyers showed, they preferred to buy women in massage parlors in Sweden or while traveling to Thailand, to other countries in Southeast Asia and to Latin America. That was their favorite places. Now, what is interesting also to look at the intersection between prostitution and pornography. And I think that's really important to do. So in that population study, 70% of men over 18 used pornography at least once a week, whereas women did not. And you can see that 41% did it frequently, at least 3 days a week. That's a lot. And we do know from interviews in all of these countries, and it's interesting with the men in Sweden when they were going to massage parlors, they always looked at pornography just before they went to the massage parlor to use it as an instruction manual to be able to ask or to force women in prostitution to carry out what they had seen online in these videos. This is just to show, this was done on the poster, and more of Swedish men do their shopping over the internet. So showing that technology, internet technology is core to buy sexual services. And so just, I did a little slide on pornography, again, the intersection between pornography and prostitution. So pornography is, of course, how the prostitution industry advertises. The absolute best way to get men to purchase is to make sure that the photos on the online sites where you can buy women are so close to what they see in pornography, because men sit there at night and they look through this and then they find somebody who fits their idea of what's happening in pornography and their preferable person. So those pictures are really important. It's also important to note, which we have in our annual progress report for the National Rapporteur, we can very clearly see that most of the women on these sites, it's not themselves who put up those photos. They don't even know that those photos are online. Some of them do it themselves, but many of them, the pimps are doing it. And they don't know until a buyer, because it's photos and it says what you are willing to do. And then a buyer comes and wants whatever, and they have no clue that this is going to happen. It's an instruction manual, as I said. What men see in pornography, they will use against women and others in prostitution. It sets trends. So for a long time, racialized women was very important in pornography. Women with disabilities have been a trend. All kinds of things you don't want to think about, maybe, has been trends and which has played out against women in prostitution. Of course, production of pornography is harmful to those who are exploited. Many, almost most of the women I know who've been in prostitution have also been made into pornography or have been made to partake in the production of pornography, even if it's just video clips that are posted online. And of course, these days, if you're then trying to get out of prostitution and you find yourself being circulated on the internet in your most exploitative situation, it's very difficult when you find that and trying to heal and get out of this and get reminded. Or if you're not reminded, maybe an employer finds you online. I've had women who have been able to get good jobs, and then the employer one day comes in with a leering smile and says, "I saw you on the internet." And what does that do to her ability to continue to work in that workplace? And of course, as I said, now I think it's important to know what men in prostitution, men who purchase women in prostitution, think about women. It is not nice. Yeah, they're laughing. I'm not using the Swedish buyers' comment here because those are under secrecy, confidentiality, privacy laws, but I'm using the ones from Belgium. The second one was a man who was very proud of being a buyer. He had, as he said, bought women in prostitution for the past 33 years. He was part of a group of friends, 10 friends, who met once a month. The very privileged men in very high positions in Belgium, and who met, had a good dinner, and then to discuss which women they had used, what they have done to them, and recommended to each other where they should go. And he just told very openly about this. Not a problem. He was proud. And, of course, both of them say, what do you mean? Women wouldn't be here if they didn't want to do that. And then I didn't put quotes on there, but the fact that men notice that women are uncomfortable, or that they have bruises, or that they are, you know, crying, makes absolutely no difference for most men who purchase sexual services, because they have paid for a service and they are, damn it, they're going to have it. There's an argument with those who say that buyers are important for the investigations and prosecutions of traffickers because they will report. Well, that is not our experience. If they report, they will do it after they used a woman. And there's research to show that, a 5-country research, very good research project, that shows that that's exactly what happens. So don't fall for that one. Yeah, we've also seen that, and it was their regional team that did this research, but before you were there, I think, we could show really clearly that there was a connection between some parts of the group of men who purchased sexual services who were involved in other forms of crime, often sexual violence. And for a period of time, the police in Stockholm were allowed to take DNA samples of men who purchased sexual services, and quite a lot of rapists were revealed that way, obviously. That does not mean that all men who purchase sexual services are criminals. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying that there is some link. What has become very interesting, I said the courts could be a problem, but something that's really interesting in the last 2 or 3 years is how the courts have dealt with violence, male violence against prostituted women. And if you look here, we've had 3 cases in 2021, 3 different cases, where the men raped, beat up, stole money, did all kinds of things from women in prostitution, and they've been sentenced to between 3 and 9 years of imprisonment for that violence. And that is really important, I think, to encourage women to report rape violence. We had a very recent case in Malmö, which is in the south of Sweden, where a woman was found on the roof of a hotel. She was stabbed, I think, 14 times, don't quote me on that one, bleeding all over. And nobody knew who she was, because she was so badly harmed, taken to the hospital. And of course, the first thing I said, she was used in prostitution. Yeah, and it so showed that it was a man who had stabbed him because she didn't do the sexual activities that he wanted her to do. And he was convicted of attempted murder just very recently. So I think it's important also to do this. Now I have 10 minutes left, so we'll ignore that one and that one. 10 minutes, right. I was alluding to a project that I was involved in, working with the National Police and the National Rapporteur on Trafficking in Women, because what we have seen the past 10 years is an increase in bogus massage parlors in Sweden. And you have them here in Germany also. When we did the project, we had lots of contacts with the Bundeskriminalamt and Landskriminalamt in some of the Länder. And what we can see is that Thai massage parlors have become an important business concept for criminals within the Thai diaspora. No blame on the Thai diaspora, but criminal elements exploit women in that diaspora. And they open massage parlors. They bring women from Thailand who has no clue of what's going to happen or where they're on tourist visas. They're in the massage parlors that are often in the center of cities, and men go there very regularly. And so we did this big project, 2-year project, where we looked at all the aspects of the organized crime groups involved, men who purchased, and we have created for the police an action plan for how to get rid of this that we hope is going to be passed by the police chiefs sometime this year, which is all aspects, everything from victim support to connections with local businesses to get rid of these. And importantly, just as in Germany, you don't have to have a permission to open these. Anybody can open a massage parlor anywhere. And so one of our big proposals is to criminalize, make sure that massage, any massage institute, whether it's medical massage, should have permission to open with inspections. And this is a real serious problem. We see this as one of the most difficult situations in Sweden right now. That doesn't mean that we're not trying to do something about it, because we're very engaged. The police is very actively going against this. But it's important, and it's difficult because the women are coming directly from Thailand. They come from a culture where women are, it's important that women make sure that their extended families can eat and have a roof over their head. So the situation in these massage parlors is horrible. Many women sleep in them. They don't have anywhere to live. They have to pay, just as women have to do here, pay for the right to be exploited, for the bed, for, you know, condoms, for everything. And they are always in debt of those who own. And so we're hoping by doing this project that this is going to change things. And so what I'm saying is that, yes, we have this approach, but we always have to be vigilant to make sure that we don't lower our guards and always find new sources where women are exploited. And we'll just take that out. One part that I think is really important to mention very quickly, that media has been incredibly helpful to us over these 24 years in order that they write about prostitution. Almost every week still, you will find articles about prostitution and trafficking, and they are not positive. So this is just one example of one of the case studies that we did in this project, and where the police raided 13 massage parlors and 600 men were found to have purchased sexual services. And the police and the media write about it immediately, which is really helpful. And we have a special rapporteur, and we do know that our legislation functions as a barrier to the establishment of organized crime groups in Sweden. But we have to be vigilant, and we have to stop them before they expand. And we've been criticized, of course. One thing that people say, oh, but if you do this, prostitution goes underground. And I think that during these 24 years, me and the National Rapporteur, we probably answered that question about 2,000, 5,000 times. No, prostitution cannot go underground, because the pimp needs to be in contact with the buyer, and they have to find each other. And if you do good surveillance, internet surveillance, you will know where prostitution takes place, and you will be able to follow the men who purchase. So there is no underground. It is a business, as if I would sell cars. I need to find the buyers of my cars. Advertisement or word of mouth, but there's always a way to find out where they are. Violence against those in prostitution increases when a ban on the purchase of a sexual service. I've already answered that. That's not the case. Men, being in prostitution is one of the most violent places you can ever be as a woman. So violence is ingrained in the Prostitution Act, the fact that the men use and sexually exploit a woman. The Prostitution Act is the violence. And then there is extrinsic violence where pimps control and abuse and all of that, but the actual exploitative act is what men do to women right there and then. we can ignore that. Yeah, right. The one argument that is said is that the police arrests women where they have they do prostitution activities in their own home, which is not true. But our procuring legislation allows us to arrest those who have an apartment and who rent it out to third parties for prostitution. So if you do that, you are as guilty as the pimp. And that's been really helpful. But of course, a woman who is in prostitution in her own home will not be evicted, because women are not criminalized. And we have no cases of that. We've gone through this many times to see if anyone has done that. And just what not to do if you want to eliminate prostitution and make sure that women and men have the same opportunities and women are not subjected to violence. Don't legalize brothels. Don't do as been said to be done. Don't decriminalize the prostitution industry. It's an ultra-liberal argument of market, you know, macroeconomics. If you totally decriminalize the market, then the market powers will sort it out, meaning those who purchase and those who sell will kind of come to an agreement, not taking into consideration the power differences between those who demand and those who are used. And don't have a tolerance situation. In Denmark, it is tolerance. In Denmark, it is illegal. Prostitution was illegal. They were part of very good policies under an older international convention. But in Denmark, you have nightclubs and brothels all over the place. They do tax. They are taxed. But the same situations as here, women in those nightclubs and brothels have to pay for everything themselves. And the pimps make lots of money. So go for a feminist human rights approach, which is what we do. You prohibit brothels. You have robust investigations and prosecutions. You don't criminalize women. You make them have access to all of the social services and victim support services. And you make sure to make this a political priority. Thank you.